Hi guys. Today I want to discuss the great mystery of a lost civilization in China called Sanxingdui. A distinctive Bronze Age culture, Sanxingdui dates between 5,000 to 3,000 years ago. Its most striking, one-of-a-kind artifacts are these large-scale bronze masks and other relics, which have attracted international attention. However, there are no historical records about this previously unknown civilization. More than 30 years have passed since its initial discovery in 1986, but there has been little progress to unravel this mystery. One thing we do know is that Sanxingdui has rewritten the history of Chinese civilization. What is the origin of this culture, and what kind of people could have created such incredible art? A metropolis of its time, Sanxingdui covered about 3.5 square kilometers or 865 acres. It had highly developed metallurgy, agriculture, and ceramics. In 1986, two giant pits were unearthed containing thousands of objects made from gold, bronze, and jade, along with ivory tusks and pottery artifacts. Most items found in the pits were damaged. Some were burnt with scorch marks. Experts say these artifacts might be ritual offerings. Carbon dating has been performed on organic items. Per Chinese archaeologists, phase 2 and phase 3 are layers that contain the bronze items. Therefore, the bronze artifacts were produced between 2100 to 1200 BC. The earliest bronze relic in China was a 4,700-year-old blade, though the consensus is that the Chinese Bronze Age began around 1900 BC at Erlitou near the Yellow River. This means the Sanxingdui bronze could predate the Chinese Bronze Age by 200 years. Here are side-by-side comparison photos of Sanxingdui and Erlitou bronze relics. Sanxingdui bronzes are much larger, more complex, and visibly more advanced. Isn't that interesting? The earlier artifacts are superior to the later ones. This might lead to an entirely new and different understanding of the development of Chinese metallurgy and hence Chinese culture. Among older artifacts, the most exciting ones are large bronze masks, including a few with gold foils. These masks have square faces, big almond-shaped eyes, and straight noses which don't reflect those of East Asian descent. They are so unusual and unlike anything ever found in China before. Other bronze objects include decorative animals such as dragons, birds, several 4-meter-tall beautiful bronze trees, and hundreds of other fantastic items. Among the collection remains the world's largest and best-preserved bronze upright human figure, measuring 8 feet or 2.6 meters. The most unusual discoveries were these oversized masks with protruding eyes, animal-like ears, and ornate nose thingies. These bronze masks demonstrate an unprecedented artistic style. They're wonderfully schematic and abstract, and would be considered modern and contemporary if made today. Besides the uncanny style, the highly accurate and advanced bronze craftsmanship astound the scientists. The thinnest portion of the bronze masks is only 2 millimeters thick. The large-scale items show well-developed technology that was most advanced in ancient China. New research suggests that Sanxingdui culture may have been moved to another site at Jinsha due to an earthquake that occurred around 3,000 years ago. Archaeologists found symbols on pottery which might belong to an ancient language. Even though the excavation work has been going on for decades, archaeologists claim that they haven't even completed 1% of the overall work. There is so much more to be discovered at Sanxingdui. It's possible that written records remain buried. The discovery of these artifacts has opened up a world of intrigue. There are too many unexplainable objects. For example, this gold foil-covered cane is not a cultural tradition of ancient China. Why do these masks not look Chinese? Who made them and why? There are several tombs with human remains found within the Sanxingdui city walls and over 30 tombs close by. Also, there are hundreds of tombs with human remains at Sanxingdui's successor city, Jinsha. DNA testing would be very helpful in trying to decipher this lost civilization. Over 15 years ago, several news outlets reported that archaeologists collected DNA data and planned to do tests on these mysterious people. However, a 2019 news release claimed that the DNA extraction was unsuccessful because of wet soil conditions. That begs the question, since there are hundreds of remains to take samples from, how can none provide useful DNA? Plus, why did they wait for 15 years to tell us the DNA analysis can be done? This is suspicious. On the Chinese version of Quora, a post states the DNA analysis has actually been done, but the results do not match Asian races. Thus, the authorities have decided not to disclose their findings to the public. Whether this is true or not, we can tell there must be something unusual about Sanxingdui people. Does this imply these people were not East Asian or even Southeast Asian? If so, this prompts questions about the history of Chinese civilization. Even though there is no DNA data available, we can find clues through metallurgy analysis. Identifying the bronze source and supply network would significantly contribute to our understanding of Sanxingdui culture. Decades ago, scientists discovered puzzling highly radiogenic lead in Sanxingdui bronzes. They then tested more ancient relics and found that many earlier Shang bronze objects contained the same kind of lead with highly radiogenic isotopic compositions. Some geochemists argue that the ores in China do not match the bronze lead isotopes. Thus, the ingots or raw materials must have been imported from a foreign land. Since these bronze radiogenic lead isotopes match the ores in Africa, some researchers claim that ingots might come from Africa. This is a controversial topic in China. No matter how you view this, the fact remains, researchers cannot find matching ores in China. This leads to the assumption that the bronze raw materials were imported from outside ancient China. Some people may think this is unlikely because ancient people were not so mobile and not able to do wide-ranging exploration. Once again, we underestimated our ancestors because they are much more capable and adventurous. Cross-regional trading was prevalent 4 to 3,000 years ago during the Bronze Age, when copper was highly prized. It was used to manufacture weapons, jewelry, tools, and other valuable goods. Hence, trading copper ingots was profitable and frequently practiced. In 2018, Czech scientists analyzed some Egyptian bronze artifacts from a German museum. They found an early dynastic Egyptian object that is high in nickel, something that is consistent with ores and artifacts from early Bronze Age Anatolia in present-day Turkey. In 2019, a 3,600-year-old shipwreck was found off Turkey's Mediterranean coast. This 14-meter merchant ship was loaded with 1.5 tons of copper ingots. Another Bronze Age sunken ship dated to 13th century BC, the Woolubrin shipwreck held mostly raw materials that were trade items. It contained 10 tons of raw copper and 1 ton of tin ingots. These findings proved there was frequent trading among states, all of which was documented in ancient Egyptian tomb texts. Turkey is relatively close to Egypt, so trading between these two nations might not seem impressive. Then how about trading between Sweden and the Mediterranean island? The Nordic Bronze Age emerged about 1700 BC. Evidence has proven without a doubt that the metals dated to the Nordic Bronze Age found in Sweden were not smelted from local copper ores. A 2014 scientific paper points out that the main sources of Swedish copper seems to come from mines in the Iberian Peninsula and or Sardinia in the Mediterranean Sea. So during the Bronze Age, Turkey exported copper to Egypt, and Nordic people imported copper from the Mediterranean area. This is proof that long trade routes among states and regions were common in ancient times. Therefore, the foreign source of the Sanxingdui and Shang bronzes shouldn't be considered unusual. It's possible that the raw copper materials of Sanxingdui were transported to ancient China from elsewhere. When did the Chinese bronze metallurgy originate? It's a question that is still being explored in academia. The Middle East was the first region to enter the Bronze Age, beginning with the rise of the Mesopotamian civilization of Sumer 5,300 years ago. Compared to the Sumerian civilizations, ancient China entered into the Bronze Age about 1,400 years later. The idea that copper smelting was not invented in China is a relatively new theory, but it's increasingly accepted by Chinese archaeologists. So far, evidence favors that the earliest bronze technology in China was stimulated by contacts with Western steppe cultures. What are steppe cultures? The Great Eurasian Steppe is an area of vast grassland which stretches from eastern Hungary to Mongolia and China. It has hot summers with dry winters. The steppe route was an ancient highway through the Eurasian steppe, extending for approximately 10,000 kilometers or 6,200 miles. Since the Paleolithic age, the steppe route has connected Europe, Central Asia, and East Asia economically, politically, and culturally through trade routes. The steppe trade route precedes the well-known Silk Road by at least two millennia. Back then, there were no border patrols. Ancient people traded and migrated with great freedom. The Middle East region invented bronze metallurgy and two-wheeled chariots. These creations worked well with the horse-riding culture in the Eurasian steppe and greatly increased the mobility of ancient people. As early as 5,000 years ago, new innovations spread rapidly and widely through the highly mobilized nomadic people who roamed across the steppe. People who settled by the steppe borders copied and utilized these innovations. For thousands of years, nomads brought trade, technology, and war by turns. When there was war, advances in metallurgy and weaponry was crucial. It's not easy to find archaeological records on nomads because they didn't have permanent structures. Despite of this difficulty, archaeologists found a pattern of burial sites with similar bronze artifacts dated to 23 to 1700 BC. These sites are scattered across northern Eurasia, particularly Siberia and Central Asia, from Finland to Mongolia and Korea. This is called the seima-turbino phenomenon. Altai Mountains are considered the homeland of this culture, which is almost in the center of the overall steppe route and close to China. These burial findings have suggested a common point of a cultural origin and rapid migration. These people were nomadic warriors and metalworkers, traveling on horsebacks or chariots. Their bronzes were technologically advanced for the time, including lost wax casting, and showed high degrees of artistic input in their designs. It has been conjectured that changes in climate in this region around 2000 BC triggered a rapid and massive migration westward into Northeast Europe and eastward into China. The seima-turbino culture existed from 23 to 1700 BC. They possessed advanced metallurgy knowledge about 200 years before Sanxingdui bronze. Therefore, 400 years before Erlitou, which is considered the earliest bronze town in China. Archaeologists have found bronze spearheads from the Russian Ural Mountains all the way to northeastern China that are imitations of the seima-turbino ones. In the region where Sanxingdui is located, researchers also found similar bronze spearheads. The nomadic culture on the Eurasian steppe have made significant contributions to the development of metallurgy in China. The steppe route not only facilitated the trade of goods and technology, but also led to the migration of people. Some consider the biggest single driver of events in European and Asian history was the migration of people across the open grasslands. On the steppe route, there are paths to get into ancient China through the Dzungarian Gate or Tian Shan Mountains, which have lakes and rivers, an ideal migration pathway. Tarim Basin is close to these paths, and it used to have a green oasis with clear rivers. Here, archaeologists found red-haired human remains, which naturally turned to mummies because of the arid conditions in the desert basin. DNA analysis revealed that in the Tarim Basin, between 4,000 and 2,300 years ago, there lived a group of people with a diverse ancestry from Europe, Mesopotamia, and Asia. These people might have come through the steppes and were from different ethnic groups. Chinese people are not a homogeneous group. There have been many rounds of interracial integrations and commingling in ancient China. Numerous ethnic groups have lived there, so much so that translators became governmental positions. For instance, Sogdian people, ancient Iranian, have been documented repeatedly in Chinese history. They were depicted as shrewd merchants and usually owned great wealth and beautiful houses. Several Chinese dynasties and their emperors have nomadic ancestries from the steppe cultures. Different races migrated in and out of regions quite frequently in ancient times. There is increasing evidence indicating the whole Eurasia and its ancient civilizations were culturally and technologically interconnected and intertwined. Great civilizations occur as a result of cultural contact and exchange. Okay, let's go back to the mysterious Sanxingdui. The DNA results are currently kept secret. This can indicate the results are unexpected, thus we can assume the Sanxingdui people might not be East Asian. If this is the case, it shouldn't be a surprise, since ancient China was a melting pot of different ethnic groups. The shock might be to those who subscribe to a homogeneous narrative of ancient China and refuse to consider any evidence to the contrary. Considering the following facts. 1. The Chinese Bronze Age started 1400 years after the Sumerians in the Middle East. 2. The Eurasian steppe route connected the Middle East, Central Asia, and East Asia during early Bronze Age. 3. Steppe cultures had advanced metallurgy technology before the Chinese Bronze Age and migrated cross-regionally. 4. These ancient nomads frequently interacted and migrated along the steppe route, whereby trading and exchanging knowledge was practiced for several millennia. 5. Some of these people went south and settled in areas like the Tarim Basin. 6. Sanxingdui is not too distant from the Tarim Basin. 7. Sanxingdui bronze technology predates other bronze cultures in China by 200 years. All of these taken together paints a picture of a group of people, probably from the Middle East or Central Asia, who possessed advanced bronze metallurgy technology and migrated either through the steppe route or the Tian Shan mountain valleys. They soared fertile plains and eventually settled in the Sichuan Basin over 4,000 years ago. These amazing people built the Sanxingdui civilization. With their highly skillful bronze-making methods and imported copper, they created these magnificent bronze artifacts with their unique artful style. They were probably the most advanced in metallurgy in ancient China. Their style and technology influenced other contemporaneous cultures. There is a lot more to be discussed about Sanxingdui. I'll probably do another video focusing on the masks and symbols. If you have any insights, please leave me a comment. If you like my video, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe. I have a wide range of topics that I want to share with you. This is Curious Being. I'm Tina. Thanks for watching and see you next time.